Last week, thousands of investors and traders descended on Las Vegas for the first MoneyShow TradersEXPO of 2024. They had the chance to attend keynotes, panel discussions, breakout sessions, and masterclasses from top market experts. One panel featured three speakers with their finger on the pulse of technology and AI. They discussed how these are driving the market.
So I guess if we take that from a public company perspective, I'm sure, I know almost what you're going to say ahead of time, but I've got to ask the question anyway. That means that this Mag 7 concern, it's X percent of the S&P, X percent of the S&P gains are coming from it. That doesn't, quote unquote, matter, right?
It's going to get, the reality, it's like Tom Lee talks about it, like the percent of tech, I don't know, like it's going to increase. It's not going to decrease. And that it goes to our view of just where the sector's heading, especially if the tidal wave now hits in terms of AI.
People have argued with me for years, like, and then, you get the law of big numbers, you get the indexers, you get the passive investment, big tech can't get bigger, can't get to 30.
That's exactly what they've been doing for 30 years.
Following this discussion, I sat down with two panelists, Dan Ives of Wedbush Securities and Keith Fitz-Gerald of the Fitz-Gerald Group, to dive deeper into their takes on tech.
Great to have you here, especially in a week that we've got all this stuff going on in the technology sector. Obviously, you were talking about the AI revolution. You know, big picture, where do you think we are in the cycle and what excites you most about what's going on out
there? I think we're in the first inning in terms of where this is all heading. I mean, look, Nvidia is really the first step. And now it's about the second, third, fourth derivatives. And I think that's what we're seeing play out across software and across the rest of the tech. And even in a macro where we believe a soft landing is really starting to take place here, it sets up for a risk-on environment.
Got it. Now, again, you talked about some developments like cybersecurity, you talked about cloud computing, obviously the chip space. I mean, briefly speaking, again, what are some of the developments in those sectors that again, you're most excited about?
Look, it's, when you think about the cloud, you still have only 45% of workloads that have moved to the cloud. So we think that's going 70, 80%. So the opportunity to monetize that, both on the cloud side, hyperscale, Microsoft, Amazon, Google, but then now what it's going to do to the software layer, in terms of names like Salesforce.com, Adobe, and others, I think this is really just the next step to what we see on this broader sort of, it's really a tech bull market that's coming out.
Well, it's interesting. You made the point that, or some people made the point, oh, we're so concerned that it's just big tech or Mag 7 driving the market. But your point was actually that it's not, if you think this is concentrated now, that's going to be the future too, right?
It's about, okay, there's seven today. What about the other 493? In terms of like, where does it all head? And I think that's why it's forest through the trees in terms of this spending wave and what it actually is going to translate into over the coming years. And we think it's $1 trillion of incremental spend. That continues to be our focus and why we're so bullish on tech.
Got it. When you look at the market reaction, the earnings have been great, but it's like you have a little disappointment and the stock market throws a hissy fit in tech. Do you think that's a short-term thing? Is that more of an issue longer term? Or more specifically, what should investors do if that happens to one of their stocks that's got a great long-term?
Look, valuations have run up. I think investors, for their own risk, have to manage that. But I think it speaks to just the overall environment that we're in. You're going to see parabolic move in terms of reactions on the upside as well as on the downside.
Yeah. Okay. Maybe one or two names that you're out there that you're most excited about.
Microsoft, Zscaler, and Palantir. And those are really ones that, from a cloud theme, especially where Palantir and Microsoft play. And then, of course, names like Apple and Tesla on the large cap side.
Okay. And one last question I guess I would ask you is, you've compared this to the 1990s and said it's not like that. This isn't the internet boom and bust again. Why is that? What's behind that?
Because the numbers. If companies are not executing and you're not seeing numbers, then it's hype. If you see it in the numbers, it's real. And that's why I think it's as real of a revolution as we've seen since 1995, star of the internet.
I guess I had one more question that I had. Your friend Keith Fitzgerald is here talking about AI is not just another technology, it's the technology. Any thoughts that you have on that? I mean, how, in the grand scheme of things, how big is the AI revolution amongst technological developments?
I think it's foundational to really the next wave of tech that we're going to see across every industry.
Now, great. Dan, thank you so much for your
time.
Thanks,
Adam. Appreciate it.
Take care. See you.
Later, I sat down with Keith Fitz-Gerald to talk about how he sees AI revolutionizing technology.
Glad to have you here. It's been a great event. I know your presentations have been packed full and everything. Great to see. I wanted to start by talking about this little known company. Nobody's invested in it at all. The ticker symbol is NVDA. What are your thoughts there?
You know, it's interesting. I mean, obviously we called that one a long time ago. We were very, very right. This is a tough business. And it's nice to hit one out of the park. I mean, and this literally has been a hit out of the park moment. You know, so Nvidia is phenomenal. This was the Michelangelo of earnings reports. Doesn't get any better than that. Yep. And to have the street recognize it is long overdue. So what's next? That's the logical question.
Absolutely.
Right? You know, we've taken out the $700 target that we put on map early on. Now I think we're looking at a split and probably $1,000. I find it very interesting today, after earnings have come out,
yep,
that suddenly you've got basically all of Wall Street revising their numbers. It's like, well, where were you guys when this thing was $150, $200, $300, $400? Yep. So individual investors have got a remarkable opportunity here. Earnings are, in fact, tripling, quadrupling. It's only a matter of time before the P and PE catches up.
Absolutely, absolutely. And let's look at NVIDIA as sort of what it says about the broader markets. I mean, it's at the center of trends that you've talked about as being not just, you know, a technology, it's the technology,
the
right?
The technology,
talk
yeah
about that a little bit.
Sure. So the mistake that many investors we encounter around the world are making is they're thinking about AI as just another technology. But the problem is it's the technology. I mean, this is on par with penicillin, the introduction of electricity, distributed power, you know, this is on par with the introduction of the internet itself, because for the first time in history, we've got the ability to manipulate and draw conclusions from data that is otherwise beyond the scale of where we've been.
Yep.
We've got 90-95% of all the data in recorded human history being created within the last 12 to 36 months. So this genie is not going back in the bottle. And if I look at this company and I say, where's it going? Well, it's going to go a long, long way from here. It's a renaissance moment. It's a pivotal moment. People ask me all the time, is this 1999? No way. This is 1995. It's very different. This is the beginning of a long trajectory and takeoff.
Well, you know, we had a great panel. You were on it, Dan Ives, Howard Tolman, and one of the big points was exactly that, comparison. Is this, you know, 1999.com?
Right.
And I think the point was, well, no, these companies are making money, surprise, surprise, and that's a good thing, right?
Well, it is, and you know, again, it's needle or the haystack time, right? And so if we look at a company like Nvidia and we say, what are they doing? The mistake that many investors are looking at is, well, that's an expensive company, it's making chips, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Well, what they don't understand is the derivatives uses for those chips. They will sell every chip they're going to make for the next 12, 24, 36 months to customers who need it for data centers. It's not just for gaming, it's for AI, it's for medical developments, manufacturing. There isn't an industry on the planet that will not touch, adapt, or adopt to AI in the next 5 years.
So what does that mean for some of the other companies out there that people are following? I mean, everybody knows, or you know, the Nvidia being the one that takes all the spotlight this week especially, but you know, what other names do you like that are sort of levered to the same trend?
Well, there's very clearly AMD, which is a competitor in the same space. So Nvidia is about the data centers. AMD is about efficiency, so it's about making what's already out there more efficient. Now, Intel, I can't tell what CEO Pat Gelsinger is doing. He's going after the PC market, which to me makes no sense whatsoever. But, you know, he's got a vision. He's brilliant. I've met him several times. He's a great CEO. I personally think you go with Nvidia and AMD because that's how you cover your bases. But I also think that begs the question, what's next for a company like Palantir? What's next for a company like Microsoft? What's next for a company like Meta? All of whom are gobbling up these AI-driven chips.
Got it, got it. Now, you know, the big question, the sort of elephant in the room, or maybe it's smaller than an elephant at this point, is the regulatory issue. You know, we talk so much about the dominance of big tech, government, is it ever going to stand in the way, or can it at this point?
You know, I hadn't thought about it in those terms. That's an interesting question. I think that if we know anything about regulators, is that they're a day late and a few trillion dollars short, and they never understand the technology they're charged with regulating.
Yeah.
So one of the dangers and the opportunities for a company like Nvidia right now at a moment in time where AI is blossoming is that they are so far ahead of the regulation that they're in the fast lane doing 200 miles an hour, and the regulators are over here in a VW microbus. So how do you balance that? I don't know the answer to it, but what I do know is that no matter what regulators do, technology is moving forward. It's going to change the world we live in.
You know, at this conference, and you know, when you just read in the mainstream press, there are people who talk about all these concerns. What's the Fed going to do? Oh, the economy's going to have recession. Oh, there's geopolitical, and so on and so forth. But I think you made a good point in your talk that, you know, the earnings are what you have to focus on in these companies, right? The macro is what to you.
Right. Well, so there's, we break this down using very simple. Everybody says keep it simple, stupid. I don't think so. I think you keep it stupid, simple. Right? I mean, that's really the way to do it. And so if we look at companies making what we call must-have products and services versus nice-to-have products and services. So a difference, for example, would be Apple. Must-have products and services. You know, people are going to use their iPhone to check on everything else in their lives. They're going to use it to send and receive money. They're going to use it for imagery. They're going to use it for learning, for AI. 100 different use cases.
Yep.
Your Peloton is going to be a very expensive laundry hanger available at grocery stores and sideshows and late night television and garage sales within a few years. So to me, must have, nice to have, that's a great example. You know, an iPad on a bike is not a business. Yeah. Creating the data that moves it is a business. So to us, the opportunities are very clear. The themes are not going to change. They're not going to disappear. AI in particular, big data in all its guises, is $3 to $5 trillion into the global economy, period, every single year for the next decade or more.
All right. Let's talk about some industries that, you know, are not tech specific, but are being, I don't know, revolutionized or
bi-tech.
Yeah, bi-tech. I mean, what do you see out there that is also promising because of that trend?
Customizable medicine is the biggest one. It's the closest alligator to the boat, to use a Navy expression, right?
Yep.
And the reason for that is that you've got companies like Pfizer, which have just been beat into oblivion. Now, I personally own it, and it's driving me nuts. But they've also got more than 300 drugs in the pipeline. They're beginning to use AI to speed up the medical discovery, treatment, and process regime. You're also talking about defense stocks. You're talking about something as simple as your neighborhood gas station. You know, when they begin to use AI as part of the purchasing and pricing process, you're talking about Walmart, which is now beginning to use it. You're talking about, you know, other companies that are beginning to package this stuff in ways that have never been seen before. Apple, for example, is going to, you know, as I say, this is going to be the year where we hear Apple and AI in the same sentence for the first time. People thought I was nuts when I said that. 6 weeks later, Tim Cook says, I'm not going to spill the beans yet. I think June, the developer conference, we're going to see Apple and AI in the same sentence. And once again, it is going to change the world. So Apple's a great example of a stock that people aren't thinking about in those terms, but really ought to have a rethink because of the way it's gonna mature.
Okay. So what does this mean when you back it out and look at sort of the broad market for this year? I mean, what kind of performance are you looking for, you know, outside of big tech, and what does it mean for the S&P?
Well, I think, you know, my take is that 2024 could be a year for the record books.
Just and that's pure and simple. And, you know, so we're not talking Wall Street standard 9 to 11%.
No, forget that. No, those. I mean, these guys have been a day late and a dollar short for a long time. You know, individual investors who are coming to things like the Money Show have in fact enjoyed the upper hand for the last 9, 12, 14 months because they're the ones who have continued to invest in these companies. Many of the institutions are now trying to play catch up, which you talk about irony. I mean, this is amazing. So I think this year, 5,100, 5,200 on the S&P 500 was my initial target, but we may take that out this week if Nvidia's earnings continue to pile higher.
It's been a day, right?
I've never in 43 years of doing this can recall when I've taken out my annual targets just a few weeks into a year. I mean, that's astounding to me. So I'm reworking those numbers, but I think it's entirely possible we're going to see another 15, even 20% to the upside if two things happen.
Okay.
One, the Fed is ultimately going to get benched. People are going to realize that either Jay Powell is full of beans or Jay Powell is going to realize he was full of beans. Yeah. Either way, when they get off to the side, they flatten rates or start cutting them. This market attracts liquidity. There's $3 to $6 trillion on the sideline. That is going to come rushing in at a speed that boggles the imagination. Any investor waiting for confirmation or waiting for the all clear signal or waiting for a bell to be rung is going to be sadly disappointed because the markets are so computerized now that most of the move is going to be gone within a matter of minutes, maybe a day at the most, and we're going to see this massive spike higher. That's the moment you're looking for. That's the catalyst. But I think most of those gains are going to be second half.
Okay.
Mike.
Okay. I do have to ask one last question, not to be a Debbie Downer, but in this scenario you've painted that is very positive and I think is very convincing, what could go wrong? What is there that if in the back of your mind you're worried a little bit about?
Well, you know, I get asked that a lot, right? Yeah. And honestly, I wouldn't be very good at my job if I worried about anything. That said, there are things that concern me. So for example, obviously a broadening war in the Middle East would do it. A catastrophic failure of the banking system would do it. Jay Powell suddenly deciding he wants to build swimming pools instead of managing the Fed would do it. Yeah. And the point is, you know, these are not black swans in the classic term. These are gray swans. Yeah. We know that they're out there. So it's really the isolated terrorist events, the breakdown of the financial system. Those are things that you can't account for. And investors say, well, what can I do? How can I help myself? Well, the answer is you buy the very best companies now, because everything is going to come under pressure.
Yeah.
So you own the best names now. You continue to focus on the growth. Because frankly, if any of those things happen, Mike, the stock market is going to be least of our worries.
No, I hear
so,
you.
And, you know.
And it's worth pointing out too, you know, the market sort of was stagnating heading into Nvidia. Some of the good reports are being sold. But here we are. I mean, people were, oh, well, that's a sign that there's a problem. Well, not really. I think it's
well,
just a standard, you know.
Yeah, well, look at how many of the perma bears have been completely shellacked since October of last year. I mean, these people, you know, the end of the earth, woe is me, you know, the financial universe is ending, there's a giant meteor out there. I mean, who knows? But the bottom line is, it is more profitable to invest in optimism every single time than it is to bet on pessimism at moments in time. Very different scenario.
Well, that's a fantastic way to end it and great advice. Keith, thank you so much for taking some time out here at The Money Show. Great calls, and people are really benefiting from your advice. So thanks again.
You're very kind. Thank you for having me back.
Thanks for watching.
We'll be publishing more interviews and bonus episodes recorded at the Las Vegas Money Show Traders Expo. So make sure you subscribe to our channel or follow the Money Masters podcast wherever you get your podcasts.